Hello and welcome to the CNC special. I'm Sam Duckett in Beijing and I'm joined by my colleagues and good friends Zhang Li and Zhang Zhao. The coronavirus has forced us to make massive changes to our daily lives. Today we'll be talking about these changes and how we managed to get through them. Now guys, when social distancing was first introduced to us, I imagine that none of us really had a strong understanding of what that term really meant. However, we look at today and it's a concept being adopted by people across the globe. So what I want to know first of all is, how did you guys adapt to the change?
For me, my kids, they couldn't go to school or go to any public areas, so I came up with a well-organized schedule to keep them busy throughout the day, just like piano, penmanship, arts and crafts.
That's fantastic. So even in a time when you were in lockdown and you couldn't go about your normal lives, you were still finding a way to be productive and keep your kids learning new things.
Yes, actually, they've got loads of new things to learn while they were at home. And one more thing is that I don't know about you guys, but I just love using the Beijing subway. But with social distancing in place, I feel it would be more responsible to drive.
Yes, sure. I love the Beijing subway as well. I have to rely heavily on subways to go between work and home. And I also believe that it is nowadays it's really responsible for someone to commute between their working places and homes via their own vehicles, because that would significantly reduce their chances of contacting other people. However, I don't have my own car, so I still have to go to work on subways. And to facilitate people's daily commute with their own vehicles, I read in the news that authorities in Beijing and other cities in China, they all have eased their restrictions on license plates. So that would make people's life easier to commute.
And easing restrictions is important indeed, because it allows people like Zhang Li to drive to work and reduce the risk that she may present to others. It also means that the subways are now more freed up. Mm-hmm. So for people like myself and Zhang Zhao, it means we can get the subway and not have to be in as much of a crowded area. Mm-hmm. I want to steer the conversation over to the professional setting and talk about our work. Mm-hmm. So I understand that for the three of us, obviously we're working in media, there's a certain level of time sensitivity that we have to pay attention to, and we have to be in constant communication with each other. After speaking to many people in the United Kingdom, they told me about their stories and their challenges working from home. On one end of the spectrum, I look at it, and you have a lot of people, admittedly millennials, who talked about the distractions they face while working at home. So they could be in the middle of writing up a report, and there would always be that temptation to turn on the television or do a bit of housework. And on the other end of that spectrum, you had people that just couldn't stop working. So they would be doing their work, finish up, put on the television, and in the middle of the night, they'd get an email, think, oh no, I feel obliged to continue working and finish my job.
Speaking of the distraction, I believe Zhang Li would experience
True.
Or faces more distractions than I do, because you have kids at home.
He has one
to
dog.
Take care of, yes. I'm living on my own, and I do feel some distractions occasionally, because working from home means that I had to clear up a space in my living room to fully concentrate mm-hmm. on the work. And it's kind of annoying to me, because I have to stare at my laptop screens or mobile phone screens in case our colleagues send me messages that related to work that is very urgent. So it's that kind of worrying mentality that keeps me like strained all day. So that's kind of annoyed to some extent.
Mm-hmm. But working, whether it's working at home or social distancing or students taking online courses, I think generally speaking, these measures took place really fast. Both the government and people in our community did their best to make the most out of a tough situation, right?
I couldn't agree more. And on that note, we're actually going to go to a video we made earlier this week where we took to the streets of Beijing to see how people are handling the pandemic.
现在你的情况是不是差不多点回正常了？现在的这个工作强度没有原来那么大，但是呢，也是正常的一些复工复产了。然后行业可以可能是需要一个转型的一个阶段。主要是出来见朋友嘛。对，这个社交的恢复对于这个疫情现在得到了控制之后，我认为是我们最重要的需求。线上社交是不能代替实体空间的这个面对面的交流的。
最近有的时候也去打打篮球或者怎样，然后看到就是疫情最严重的时候，基本上无论是街道还是哪儿都没有什么人，然后现在看到，人也多起来了，然后基本上还是挺高兴的。
嗯，你有什么感受？
挺开心的呀，
是吧？
就觉得。
现在就是没有完全的开放，然后但是可以打篮球，篮球还可以，然后健身房可能希望它陆续好好开放吧，因为最近确实胖了好多。觉得出来就是看到人这么多，感觉就是疫情反正也快结束了，就是有一种希望吧，就感觉还是很好的。
The interesting thing is when I was out on the streets in Beijing, the one thing that I learned is that everyone's in high spirits. They're not dwelling on the months of time that they've had to spend at home. They're excited about being able to go out and do the things that they like.
Yes, it's good to see so many people back on the streets now.
And that's the real Beijing.
I want to steer the conversation out and talk a bit about face masks. Mm-hmm. Now, face masks, as it's my understanding, are pretty commonplace in China. I'd seen them on the subway and out on the streets way before the pandemic had hit us. In the United Kingdom, for example, that's a completely different story. I had never seen anyone wear a face mask in a public setting in the UK up until this year. My mum, who is just one example of many, actually had a terrible time with them. When the pandemic broke out in the United Kingdom, they sold out instantly, meaning she wasn't able to buy them. And even after she was able to get her hands on face masks, she found them very uncomfortable to wear. I imagine that's probably because she had no previous experience with mm-hmm. them.
So is it now compulsory to wear a mask in the UK?
It's not compulsory, it's advisory.
Okay.
And I think because there's a lack of understanding about how useful face masks are during the pandemic, a lot of people have been reluctant to wear them. The advice that I gave my mother, that I would give to anybody else who's facing a similar situation, is just try and social distance as much as possible and avoid going outside. I want to turn to Zhang Zhao and ask you a bit about the situation of wearing face masks in China and how all this came about.
Yeah, sure. Most of Chinese people are quite used to wearing masks already because first we had a SARS outbreak in 2003, and back then people had to wear masks, and it was then the air pollution during the last few years. The environment has obviously been improved. Over the course of the last 20 years, Chinese people have developed the tradition or to wear face masks during extreme weathers. The good thing is that over the course of last month, I would say that the production capacity of face masks in China have been gradually resumed and back to the normal level. And I think on a positive note, I think Chinese government is now able to donate face masks mm-hmm. to other countries that are deeply impacted by the epidemic nowadays.
And I love that example because it shows people pulling together and trying to help out other countries, the example you gave of the Chinese government, helping them get through this tough time. I think that's a fantastic story, Zhang Zhao. Li, what's your take on the situation?
The teachers at my kid's school, they all went back to their home countries before the Spring Festival. And by the end of February, because of the outbreak around the globe, they couldn't come back to China. So we were told in our WeChat group, almost all the teachers, they couldn't get any PPE, so we pitched in and we bought some basic protective equipment and shipped them around the world, which has made me realize that we are actually connected within one community.
You know, it's really funny that you should mention that story because it's actually reminded me of a really touching story that I saw recently myself. So obviously the e-commerce sector in China has been a massive help during this time. It's been a real lifesaver, providing us with food, entertainment, anything that we need. And when the outbreak hit Wuhan, which was the original epicenter of the coronavirus in China, the delivery system had to keep on going to help people. And the delivery drivers, obviously, they're at the front lines, they're risking their lives, and they're just trying to do their part to make everyone's lives a little bit easier. I saw the story of one driver in Wuhan who had actually continued working on his birthday during the epidemic. Mm-hmm. And there was one customer who thought this was really tough for him, and she decided to buy him a birthday cake on the online platform. And the driver himself broke
That's
out in
so
tears.
Sweet.
Well, I just felt really bad about myself. I felt, wow, I can't remember the last time I had done something that selfless. But as Zhang Li's story tells us, and as that story tells us, in times like this, it's showing compassion towards each other and helping each other get through it that's going to be the best way to go.
Mm-hmm. E-commerce as a lifesaver, that goes for me as well. And I think e-commerce is one of the few least impacted industries in China during the epidemic. For example, I saw the other day on the news that JD.com, Jingdong, that mm-hmm. it saw over 20% of revenue growth during the first quarter of this year. I think that's quite remarkable and encouraging, especially during this hard time.
Now, despite the surge of e-commerce in China, the economy was still hit pretty hard, with many shops, restaurants and small businesses having to close their doors for many months. Fortunately, they've now managed to reopen and are bouncing back.
Indeed, Sam, the closure across the spectrum have significantly impacted China's economy, and we saw the GDP growth in the first quarter of this year shrinks 6.8%. That's a heavy loss for China's economy, and the situation in other countries looks also pretty grim. But the good news is that China is now seeing a recovering trend, and we see a lot of restaurants, shopping malls, parks, and etc. A lot of places have reopened.
Mm-hmm, exactly. China's economic recovery showed positive signs during the Qingming Festival. Let's take a look at these statistics. Business circles saw 68% growth in customer flow, and businesses saw 32% growth in revenue.
It's fantastic to see these businesses persevere and come back stronger than ever.
And speaking of e-commerce, the city of Hangzhou.
Wait, hold up a second, John Lee. Isn't that your hometown?
Exactly. Well, the city of Hangzhou, where the e-commerce giant Alibaba is headquartered, released 60 million yuan worth of vouchers during the five-day May Day holiday, and which raked in 1 billion yuan in actual spending.
And it's not just big businesses as well. You can see loads of small business shops and restaurants right here in Beijing who have had been closed for months are now able to reopen their doors. Now, in the short term, they're probably not going to make big profits, but it's just great to see that they've managed to persevere and endure during this tough situation. And we actually went to my local gym in Beijing to see how they're doing. With business finally returning to normal in Beijing, shops and other venues are finally able to open their doors after months of being on lockdown. We've arrived at my local gym to see how they're doing now they can finally let people back inside.
疫情期间，你们当时是怎么营业？比方说网课等等。在这疫情期间，我们是严格遵守，就是动用区体育局这个标准，然后规定的时间来营业的。然后其次就是我们在疫情期间，由于跟要跟客户保持一定的沟通，然后我们开展了抖音直播和抖音视频的一些内容。到店必须出示北京健康宝，然后是有绿码的。我们看到绿码之后，然后测量你的体温，测量体温之后再登记，因为我们现在全都是预约制的，预约制的。如果您是没有跟我们俱乐部工作人员，包括线上线下的预约，是不可以进入店内的。预约呢，我们是每个时间段每2个小时的时间段，最大的容量就是60人。
And that was a trip to my local gym. And speaking of working out, I actually spoke to a friend in the UK recently who told me the sale of bicycles in the UK has seen a bit of a spike, and it's where people are trying to use the pandemic as an opportunity, making the best out of a bad situation and get a bit more exercise in. And that's the thing about the coronavirus. Obviously, it's a bad situation, but the important thing is that we make the most out of it and we don't let it defeat us. That actually brings us to the end of today's show. I want to thank Zhang Zhao and John Lee for joining me for this conversation. I found it very educational, and I'm hoping people watching also feel the same. Thank you.